pray, God, we give you praise that that is true, that we are all that you say that we are, and you say that we are your own. Well, there's so many things that we could be known as, but there's just nothing greater than being known as your sons, as your daughters, as ones who you chose to adopt into your family because you love us, you forgive us, you have created us, and you have made us for a relationship with you. God, I pray that this day you would help us to understand a little more of our true identity in you, Lord Jesus. Forgive us for the times when we allow ourselves to be defined by things that are not of you. Lord, we want to be defined by our identity in you. God, we love you and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated, friends. We want to welcome you to Stillwater Church. My name is John. I'm one of the pastors here, and it's just an honor to get to worship Jesus with you here this weekend. We are wrapping up our message series called At the Movies, where we've been looking at a different movie each week. And this week, we are going to look at a movie. It's very relevant to the song we were just singing. It's about a man who is one of the most, probably one of the most famous prisoners, at least in musical form, of all time. It's a movie called Les Mis. You've probably heard of it before. It's based on something that's been a musical for a long, long time. I remember I first encountered this when I was in elementary school, and there was some probably low-budget version of it coming through our town, and we had to go on a field trip and see it, and as a third grade, fourth grade, whatever it was, boy, I was not overly impressed, I must say. We called it Les Miserables because we thought it was miserable. And you know, I guess some things only change so much, because confession here, when I went to watch it this past week, I only made it through about three quarters of the movie. I don't know. I mean, it starts off as this great story, right? And that's what we're going to talk about in the message. And then, like, it goes into, like, politics and romance and more singing I know, I have no culture, right? Like, that's just, I had to go fix something on the car just to feel like, you know, a man again. I don't know. But I must say, the part that I watched, I did really like. The part about the beginning of the story, it's about this guy, again, very famous prisoner, and he loses his identity in prison. While he's in prison, he's known as prisoner 24601. His name is Jean Valjean, but he's referred to as prisoner 24601 for 19 years. Now, apparently a lot of people have better taste than me, because this is such a famous story. There's been lots of famous prisoner 24601s in our culture as a result of this story. My favorite being, of course, Marge Simpson was prisoner 24601 when she went to prison, but many others wore this number. And for Valjean, it was a symbol of the fact that he lost his identity. He was a man who lived in France, 18th century, very rough time, where there was a small percentage of people who were very, very wealthy. They controlled most all of the wealth and the power, and the majority of the folks lived a very challenging life. Valjean struggled to even feed his family, to put a roof over their head, to provide these basic necessities. And so once, in a moment of desperation, he breaks a window at a bakery. He breaks in and steals some bread to feed his family. He's caught, and he's sentenced to 5 years of hard labor. And then he tries to escape. It's not a good choice, but he tries to escape. He's caught in that, and his sentence is extended to 19 years. So for 19 years, Jean Valjean becomes prisoner 24601, and he loses his identity. He's put on parole, released from prison, but it's only so much of good news, because he has to take these parole papers with him everywhere, and he has to tell folks who he is, a dangerous criminal. And so the people don't want to hire him, they don't want to have him around, they don't want to provide housing or whatever it may be. So he spends a little bit of time kind of on the run, and life is very, very difficult. Eventually, he finds this monastery and this bishop who brings him in and very generously feeds him, gives him a place to sleep, a place out of the cold. And it's really a great example of what the church should be. You know, Jesus tells us that the prisoner is one of the people that we should be very, very concerned about. Because when we love on those who are incarcerated, or those who were incarcerated, we're loving on Jesus himself. It's one of my favorite things about this church. We have a great ministry that we participate in called Kairos Prison Ministry. And we've got some guys going back later this month to share Jesus' love once again with those who are incarcerated. And I know a bunch of you are making cookies again, so we can always use cookies for this, because it's a big help in terms of reaching people for Jesus. Because when you're in prison, a homemade cookie is a big, big deal. So the bishop reaches out to Valjean and brings him in, but his kindness is not necessarily repaid by Valjean. Look at how he responds.
Bless the food we eat today. Bless our dear sister and our honored guest.
Somebody who can't be trusted. And even when released from prison, he goes right back to that, even with a guy who's showing him great kindness. He goes and he steals a bunch of the silverware. And this would have been worth a lot of money. I mean, to someone like him, this would have been worth some serious money in those days. This is not like the Walmart grade stuff we have in my house or maybe your house. This is expensive stuff. And so he steals it. He gets caught once again. And all the bishop has to do is say, yep, that was mine, and Valjean's back to prison. Back to 24601 once again. But instead, he does something radical. He tells a little bit of a fib, right? He says, I did give this to him. In fact, he forgot the best pieces. He shouldn't have rushed off without these. So here's Valjean expecting to go back to prison, and instead, he's given this amazing gift. But it's not just simply a gift. It's kind of like when Jesus saved the woman who was caught in adultery. Remember that? They were going to kill her, and he saves her, but he says, go and sin no more. This is the challenge that is given to Valjean. He is challenged to go and to be different from who he has been. And really, it's all of our stories. We're all him in one way or another, because we too are in need of grace. We were people who have sinned, who our sins have separated us from God, and so we need to be saved, and we can't fix that on our own. We can't just be good enough to have our goods outweigh our bads or something like that. That's not how it is, because God's standard is God's own holiness, perfection, and we fall way short of that. And so God has given us this free gift of grace. Ephesians 2:8-9, God has saved you by this grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. It doesn't matter if you think you're like the best person in this room or the worst person in this room. For all of us, it's a free gift of God. Verse 9, salvation is not a reward for the good things we've done, so that none of us can boast about it. We have been forgiven, and that is an act of grace. And you know, Valjean is now confronted with a choice and an opportunity. He can go on and continue this life of stealing. He can use that silver to just sell that and become a little better thief. He can continue this life of crime, or he can change. He can respond to this grace and make it a very difficult choice to choose what is right. Last weekend, Sierra gave us a great message, and she challenged us to take the hard right instead of the easy wrong. And you know, when it comes to changing, to being more like Jesus, that's often a hard right. It's not an easy decision to make, but thank God we don't make it on our own strength. We have the power of the Holy Spirit living inside of us. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead helps us to make the right choices, to choose Jesus, to choose freedom, to choose to leave that life of sin behind. So friend, there's hope for you today. There's hope for me today. And the hope is not in myself. No, the hope is in the power of God working through His grace. I'm thankful for that grace, and I hope that you are too. You know, grace rewrites the story of your life. You may have lived a life up until this point that there's a lot of things you're embarrassed by. A lot of moments of your life that if we somehow put them on the big screen, you'd want to run and hide. But friend, listen, grace can rewrite the story of your life. God, through His grace, wants to write a new story for you. So you, like Valjean, get this choice to go forth and not receive the punishment that you and I deserve, but instead to receive God's grace and to go forth and to live differently and to live better. Valjean, he takes some time and he processes this pain that he's been through in his life, these 19 years in prison, and yet the contrast of this grace that he's being shown now. On the one hand, he was given a punishment that is so much greater, so much worse than crime. But on the other hand, he's given grace that is so much greater than what he deserves. So what is he going to do with this? How is he going to respond? And as you watch him sing this song here, I want you to see how first he kind of processes the anger, and then he looks at the generosity of the bishop, and how it just doesn't really make sense. And then he talks about how he can be different. You'll see that he's holding these papers, which are his parole papers, these papers that define him as a criminal. And watch and see how grace changes his life. Let's check this out.
What have I done, sweet Jesus? What have I done? Become a thief in the night, become a dog on the run. Have I fallen so far, and is the hour so late, that nothing remains but the cry of my hate? The cries in the dark that nobody hears, here where I stand at the turning of the years. If there's another way to go, I missed it 20 long years ago. My life was a war that could never be won. They gave me a number and they murdered Valjean when they chained me and left me for dead. Just a still in a mouthful of bread. teach me love. He treated me like any other. He gave me his trust. He called me brother. I rightly claim for God above. Can such things be? For I had come to hate the world, this world that always hated me. And I'd be back beneath the lash upon the rack. Instead, he offers me my freedom. I feel my shame inside me like a knife. He told me that I had a soul. How does he know what spirit comes to move? Is there another way to go? I am reaching for that fall, and the night is closing in as I stare into the void, to the well-born my sin. I'll escape now from that world. From the world of shalt thou shalt. Shalt thou shalt is nothing now. But now the story must begin.
A new story must begin. God wants to rewrite the story of your life through his grace. You know, in the Gospel of Luke, there's a great story that has some similarities to this one. It's a story we know as the story of the prodigal son. It starts here in Luke 15, 11. It revolves around a dad and his two sons. It says this, Jesus told them this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, I want my share of your estate now before you die. So his father agreed to divide the wealth between his sons. Now, to us, this seems kind of offensive. I mean, it's, or at least kind of weird. But sometimes in our society, parents will choose to give their children money or whatever before they die. They, you know, say, hey, I'd rather see you spend it than give a bunch to you when you die or something. But it's not that way in this culture. See, in Jesus' day, how they would do it is that the eldest son would get two-thirds of the estate, and the other children would divide the remainder of the estate, which doesn't seem very fair, I know, but the reason is because they wanted to make sure that the family name and family business could go on. So if there wasn't enough to help all the kids, we can at least help the eldest and maybe the youngers to work for that child or something like that. It'd be a way of not dividing it up so much that it would get watered down, if you will. It was just their way of doing things. But this didn't happen. This didn't happen until Dad died. You don't ask for this ahead of time. It's not an option. And because you're part of the family there, you participate in the family business. That's how things were done. It wasn't like, you know, you just went off and kind of did your own job. You tended to stay with what the family did. And here, Dad is a landowner. We'll learn later that he has servants. So Dad's very, very successful. They've got something good going on there. And so for the son to say, I want my money and I want out of here, is basically to say, Dad, you're as good as dead to me. I'm done with this family. I've had it. I'm cashing out and I'm out of here. Now, a logical response by the father was, okay, you get nothing. See you later. Would have been okay, right? I mean, maybe the same response you'd give your kids if they came and said, hey, I want my share of the estate. Like, okay, great. Here's $1.50. See ya. You know, you probably wouldn't just cash everything out because they asked. With the father, he's different. He does something radical, and he just does it. He agrees to defy divine will. And so it says then, verse 13, a few days later, the younger son packed up all his belongings and moved to a distant land, and there he wasted all his money on wild living. So in our terms, it's like this kid's basically, this young man's given probably at least six figures worth of money in our terms. At least six figures worth of cash. And he goes and he buys himself a plane ticket to Vegas. And he shows up, and you imagine him walking down the strip that first night. There's the neon lights everywhere, and there's all the temptations and all the stuff. And he says, yes, I made the right choice here. This is the kind of life I should be living. And he acts as if this money that he's given will last infinitely. So he starts living it up. He becomes the party king. I mean, he's dining in five-star restaurants. He's staying at Caesar's Palace. He's gambling, the prostitutes, the shiny cars, all this stuff. It's everything he wants. A life of total indulgence. He takes a third of what dad has earned throughout his entire life. And believe it or not, he parties so hard that he blows it all. Eventually, he blows it all. And it happens actually at the worst possible time. In our terms, it's kind of like he runs out of money right about the same week that, remember when Lehman Brothers went belly up a decade ago? It's right that same week, right? This is when he finds himself out of money. So work is hard to come by, and he's in serious, serious trouble. Verse 14, about this time that his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him out into the field to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs looked good to him. But no one gave him anything. What a fall. I mean, he goes from being the beloved son of a very successful man to being the party king who's got all the friends because he's got all the money, to now being the man who's got nothing. Nothing. He can't even get a respectable job. Because it's hard for us to grasp how awful this is, because for Jews, pigs are unclean animals. So you can't be around them. It's against the religious law. So effectively what he's doing is, he's thrown out his identity as a son. Okay, he cashed that in when he took all the money, and then he squandered it all on partying. Next, he squandered his identity as a Jew, because now he's doing a job that will make him perpetually unclean. So it's like, basically, he can't go to church anymore. But he takes this job because he's going to starve. He goes from eating at the finest steakhouses to having absolutely nothing. And nobody even feels sorry for him enough to give him something because the economy is so bad. He's truly gone from the top to the bottom here, okay? The Bible tells us that one day he comes to his senses and it hits him. He realizes, he says, you know what? The lowest guy in my father's household has it way better than I have here. I mean, the lowest, most base level servant. Okay, the guy who got the worst performance evaluation of anybody last year, he's better off than I am here feeding these stinking pigs. So I'm going to go home. I'm going to go home, and I can't ask to be a son anymore. I squandered that. But instead, what I'm going to do is I'll go home, I'll fall at my father's feet, and I'll beg for a job. That's going to be pretty tough. I mean, you have to know he has exhausted every single option, because he's got to go home and he's got to face dad. And when dad says, why do you want a job? I gave you a third of everything I've got. I gave you a ridiculous sum of money. You're going to have to tell him what you did with that money. And you're going to have to go home and see dad smelling like pigs. This is going to be tough. He's going to have to say those three hardest words in any language: I was wrong. Because you know, it's really hard to be redeemed if you don't think you need saving. And for all of us, there comes a point at which we have to say, are we going to be honest about our sin? Are we going to be honest about how it separated us from God and how we desperately need a Savior? Or are we going to try to keep acting like Party King here, the one who feels that somehow on our own accord that we can buy our way out of our problems? Friends, it just doesn't work. He's traded in his identity as a son, so he decides to come home and maybe restore it as a servant. Listen to how Dad responds, because Dad could have responded in any way, remember? Dad could have shut the door on him when he comes home. I mean, he doesn't have to let him back in. He has written himself out of the family. But verse 20 is interesting. It says, so he returned home to his father. And while he was a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son. He embraced him and kissed him. I think this is one of the best verses in all the Bible. It gives me the chills every time I read it, because it's one of the most powerful examples of how God looks at me and you. I mean, there's a few things we notice here. First, the Father sees him when he's a long ways off. And let me tell you, friends, that was no coincidence. Dad didn't just have good timing that day. No, the fact that he sees him a long ways off means that he has been looking over and over and over. So while his son has been off blowing his money and sleeping with prostitutes and doing all this crazy stuff, every day Dad has been looking for him. Every morning when Dad gets up, Dad walks to his room and just prays and says, God, let him have snuck in the night. Let him be back. Every time he walks by that driveway, Dad looks down the driveway, just hoping, praying that he might see his son. His son doesn't deserve to be there, but that doesn't mean that Dad has stopped loving him. In fact, it's interesting, because it says, filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, the one who had sold off the to be his son, still considered his son. And he embraces him. He kisses him. He's filled with, just overwhelmed with love for this boy. Some of you know what it's like to love your kids like that. For you've loved your kids through some really, really tough times. And I'm humbled by the love that you show to your kids. And as even as incredible as that is, God's love is even greater. God's love is even greater than even the best earthly parent could ever show. His son kind of stays on script here. Verse 21, he says, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy of being called your son. But his father said to the servants, quick, bring the finest robe into the house and put it on him. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet. Kill the calf that we've been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast. For this son of mine was dead and is now returned to life. He was lost and is now found. So the party began. Think about that. My son was dead. He wrote himself out of this family. We didn't even think that we would ever see him again, and yet here he is alive. He was lost, and now he's found. The son comes in with the planned speech, Dad, I've sinned against heaven, against you, not worthy to be called your son. Could I get a base level job around here, something, so I don't starve to death? And Dad, I love the fact, he doesn't even respond to that question. He doesn't even give it the dignity of response. Of course, he's not going to do that. Because, yes, he's gone away. Yes, he doesn't deserve to be here. Yes, he does not deserve to be called son anymore. But guess what? You can't stop being son. You can't stop being daughter. When God adopts you into his family, God never stops loving you. Amen. God's grace, when Jesus died, it was for everybody. It was for you and for me and for everybody, for the one that you love and the one that you don't think deserves this grace. It's for them too, because it's for everybody. It's a free gift. I don't deserve it. You don't deserve it. And that's what makes it so great. That's what makes it so great. You know, we say around here, it's kind of a central part of our vision, that you matter to us and you matter to God. And it's true. There's just nothing you can do that would make God stop loving you. I don't care how much you've messed up in your life. Maybe Jean Valjean's story or the prodigal story is your story. Listen, friends, there is hope, because the hope is in Jesus Christ. The hope is in how good God is, not how bad you or I have been. Because we believe in a grace that is greater than all of our sins. A grace that is greater than all of our sins. That's what we believe in. And you know, this parable is like a theme story for the church, because it's our story. It's all of our stories. Every single person here, this is who we are. We're the one who was far off from God, and Jesus has given his life for us. So thus, the church is not a place where we blame people for their brokenness. It doesn't do any good just to kick people while they're down. No, we still call sin what it is, but we celebrate redemption and moving forward. That's exactly what Jesus did. When the woman caught in adultery comes, he's not ashamed saying, yes, this is sin. Go and sin no more.
That's right. Amen.
Jesus wants you to be free. Jesus wants, he offers you this day forgiveness and grace and unconditional love that is greater than what you or I could ever, ever deserve. The church, thus, is a place of redemption. Verse I will quote to you all the time, 2 Corinthians 5:17. This means that if anyone belongs to Christ, has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. This is the life that Jesus offers to you. And you know, if you're here and you've got skeletons in the closet or parts of your past that nobody knows about, and you're so embarrassed by, friend, Jesus, he offers you forgiveness that's totally free, that's totally unearned, that's not something you could deserve. And this is the gift that God offers to you this day. And you know, friend, my prayer is that you would say yes to this gift. Because you don't have to. God's grace is not forced on anybody. God gave us free will when he created us. He hasn't taken that away. It's still there. So you get to choose whether you want to accept this gift or whether you want to leave it behind. Valjean could have gotten up that day and left that silver behind because he didn't want the strings attached, right? The bishop said that he, you know, by giving this stuff, he's saved his soul for God. Now, of course, the bishop's not the one who saves him. It's God who saves him. But God offers you this grace. How foolish would it be to walk away into the cold and just leave that gift? How foolish. God is offering you the greatest gift that you could ever be given. Forgiveness for your sins. Being made right with God. A grace that is greater than all your sins. And you know, Jesus offers this, and we receive it by simply saying yes. Yes, Jesus, I confess that I'm a sinner, that I need you to forgive me, that I need you to give me a new identity so that I won't be known anymore as this prisoner of sin. But no, I'll be your daughter. I'll be your son. I'll be a new creation in you. Something that I could never earn on my own, but something accepting what you have freely given to me. I'm going to pray, and I invite you to pray along with me and receive that grace. Would you pray? Pray with me. Lord Jesus, we confess that we too have sinned. From things that seem little to us to things that seem catastrophic to us, They all separate us from you, and we're sorry. We take a moment right now in our hearts to confess our sins to you. Jesus, thank you for your love and your forgiveness. We ask that you come into our hearts, that you would forgive us, that you would change us, that you would fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit, that we would be different, that we could go forth from this place and choose you, to choose holiness, to choose a different life. Lord, help us to be a people who rip up those parole papers that have defined us and instead find an identity that can only be found in you, Jesus. Thank you for your grace that's greater than all of our sins. Lord, we love you and we pray this all in Jesus' holy name.